I'm going to call the February 7, 2018 Public Works Committee meeting to order with roll call.
Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
We have no changes to the agenda, but we do have some minutes from January 3, 2018.
Sure, I'll go ahead and make a motion to approve the minutes of January 3, 2018.
And I will second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Under pending, we have none. Takes us to new. And item number one is our storm response status update. Mr. Gilardi, what do you have for us this month?
Good evening, everyone. How is everyone today?
Doing very well. Hello.
Very good. Okay, for the month of January, we're going to do the storm update. This month, the sewer division assisted with the debris removal of our flood control list, 91 north and south, 43 east and west, and our hot spots. So we keep an eye on that. Earlier this month, we had a little bit of thawing and we had some drainage. So we like to keep an eye on those and we remove all the debris just to make sure there's no problems in the long run. For the month of January, we responded to 12 sewer calls. And none of those were storm related. They were all sanitary. And 11 out of the 12 were residential issues. And there's one on our side that's already scheduled for repair. I'm just waiting for a couple good days. This month, the storm GAFAX began its cleaning and TV work of Carter Street. There's going to in preparation of the pavement replacement with the engineering department. We've also received concrete replacement lists from the engineering department. So what we'll do is we'll go in and we'll put the camera in, make sure the sewers are good. We'll clean them, make sure there's no issues when they begin construction. If there is, they can handle it at that time. The storm GAFAX has completed the following areas: Baldwin, Linden, Inwood, Parkway, Mulberry, Station Street, Bramble, Thistle, and Thornapple. And we will be going, once we finish the Carter Street job, we will be going in Arnold Miller Parkway, Beaver Meadow, Davis Industrial, Enterprise, and Fountain. This month, pretty much, we've just been doing a lot of snow plowing. And when the weather breaks, we go out and we dig. We've done a couple excavation jobs, but I have about five scheduled. So I'm just waiting for some good weather. Any questions?
No visual aids.
Visual aids. I'm glad you brought that up. We'll be doing visual aids later throughout the year. I don't want to give you too much too soon, but they will be coming.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good day.
That brings us to item number two, the City of Solon 2018 Infrastructure Improvements Report. That, Mr.
Good
Bush.
Evening. How's everyone tonight?
We're doing well tonight.
Regarding our infrastructure improvement monthly update, nothing new to report as far as updates to the committee, except that we did get our final numbers relative to our unexpensed balance of infrastructure fund starting January 1st and our estimated revenue. So those numbers have been updated. Everything else is no news. Or no new news to report.
Okay.
But if you did have any questions, I can address those now.
Item number three, the 2018 annual street striping program contract, 2018.05.
The engineering department opened bids for our street striping on January 26th. Two sealed bids were received. One was from Duramark Incorporated, the other from Aramark Incorporated. The apparent low bidder was Duramark in the amount of $187,870. Our engineer's estimate was $195,000. We did check their references, which I've provided to the committee in my memo, and we also have done work with them in the past, with this project being 2009, 2011, 2013, and 14. Based on our recent reference checks and our previous working relationship with Duramark, we are recommending that the 2018 street striping program be awarded to Duramark in the amount of $187,870.
Any questions?
I just have one. Do we do all the striping on all the streets every year, or you do them?
Some streets get more striping than others. Obviously, our mains get striped more than once. typically our residential streets, crosswalks, that kind of thing, get done at least once.
Okay.
I do have a question for you, John. Doesn't ANA Safety usually bid this contract?
They do, and funny you should ask, because I did look that up. They were our contractor the last 3 years, 2015, 2016, and 2017. They were at our pre-bid meeting this year, but opted not to bid. And again, we don't get many bidders with this contract just because we require them to be ODOT certified stripers. So it really limits the bidding pool already. So typically, like this year, I think we had four contractors show up to the pre-bid. One was from Norwalk. ANA Safety has different offices throughout Ohio and Duramark and Aramark. Those are typically the 3 to 4 people that we typically see.
Yeah, I just, in the past, I think they've always kind of been one of the companies that bid it. So
yes.
I was curious if you knew as to why perhaps they didn't, but they did actually come to the...
They were at the pre-award.
Pre-award.
Or, I'm sorry, pre-bid. Sorry.
Pre-bid meeting.
Yes. Okay.
There's no other questions?
Okay, I'll go ahead. Make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing Duramark Incorporated to be awarded the contract for the 2018 annual street striping program as the lowest and best bidder, and this will be in the amount of $187,870.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
It takes us to item number 4, the SOM Center Storm Sewer Replacement Project Contract 2015.33. This will be the final closeout. What do you have for us, John?
This is a final closeout for the SOM Center Storm Sewer Replacement Project 2015-33. The original contract value was $85,978.75. Not all of the quantities and contract value were used, and the final contract amount ended up being $73,177.23. With this final change order request, we are asking for 413 days to be added to the contract schedule, predominantly for the completion of the punch list items and the acceptance of the grass. And we did have, and this was all predicated on some prevailing wage issues that we were working out with them at the time. So all of these things got postponed in the whole process of the project.
Any questions? You have a motion?
I can do that one. Give it a whirl.
Go for it.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the final change order for the SOM Center Storm Sewer Replacement Project to close out the contract in the amount of $73,177.23 and to extend its final completion date of the project to December 8th, 2017.
Second.
Motion and a second. Further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, John. Item number 5, the 2017 Annual Asphalt Repair Program Contract 2017.08. Good evening, Dan.
Hi, Dan. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, committee.
Are you feeling better?
Yes, much better. Thank That's you very good. Much.
Back on room air.
Our Looking annual asphalt contractor, Roniak Paving, completed all of the work substantially on the project with the exception of one location, which is the front entrance at the Grantwood Clubhouse and a widening of the asphalt there and some changes on the sidewalk that kind of was a mutual decision that we best not pull the trigger on that late in November with Glen Allen to be finished with considerable amount of curb work and asphalt paving there and people's drive aprons to get back in. So he's requesting an extension of 188 days till May 31st of this year, which time will give us about a 3-week window or so to get that work completed when it's most convenient for Grantwood. So I'm requesting an extension of that time.
Dan, I have a question. When will the asphalt plants, generally, when do they reopen to the point of being in the full swing of things?
It's all weather and job related, but for the most part, I consider that mid-April is a reasonable time to expect that they can begin installing asphalt. A lot of the grant word work is concrete work, so there'll be some milling, some storm sewer extending work to move the curb, and then some curb and sidewalk installation. And then honestly, just topping it with asphalt is the only asphalt work that needs to be completed there. Just that little U in front of the clubhouse.
So you're comfortable this is enough time?
Yeah, very comfortable. Okay. And in addition to that, all the places where they did curb work over the past season, there wasn't really time to get grass established in October and November, so they'll be touching up all that grass and planting where it hasn't been planted on Glen Allen.
Okay, I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared extending the completion date for the annual asphalt repair program to May 31st of 2018.
I'll second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
That takes us to item number six, the 2013 on-site supplemental construction inspection services contract 2013.02. Dan, you're looking for a change order on this?
Again, it's a no-cost change order to extend the time for 2 months from October 31st to December 31st of 2017, just for whatever work they needed to do to complete the traffic signal project for us. They've been our traffic signal inspection services contractor throughout the whole duration of that project since 2013. This is the last we'll be using their services on that contract. So
I have a question. We're not going to be closing it out with this legislation as well?
Typically, the professional services contract is closed the purchase order, and that's
it closes
over.
Out at the
there's really
at the
no
end of it.
Punch list okay. or inspection required.
Okay.
Okay.
Any questions? Entertain a motion.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation recommending the approval of time extension for the 2013 supplemental on-site construction inspection services contract from the present October 31st, 2017 to December 31st, 2017.
We're going to need an explanation as to why this is under
emergency for the reason of providing continuity in inspection services through closeout of the citywide traffic signal improvement project.
Second.
Motion and a second. Anything further? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
That takes us to item number seven, the Bainbridge Road Culvert Contract 2015.28. Dan, looks like you're looking for a change order, similar change order.
Yes, exactly. Another no-cost time extension change order to extend the contract, allow the contractor to complete the work. First, I'd like to say that there's a change order form attached to the request, and it doesn't have all of the signatures right on it, and you probably received one that has everyone except the law director. So what I'm asking is that that you would approve this and forward it to City Council contingent upon us getting the law director's signature before council. And basically, the culvert project, which honestly was expected that it would be able to get going a little bit sooner, but because of material approvals and availabilities for steel in particular for the culvert, they got off to a little bit of a late start and ended up performing the work in weather that was a lot worse conditions than what they were anticipating in August and September. With rains and snow melt, the water raises really quickly in the stream and in the culvert, and it really discontinues their work for the until the water goes back down to a manageable, controllable level, which is probably about 18 inches, to be honest with you. It regularly goes up to about 5 feet in these freeze-thaw conditions we've been having lately. At this point in time, the about 72, 73 feet of culvert that's being lined on the inside has both of the walls poured on each side. It just needs a ceiling poured that has to be done in about five or six consecutive pours, which could take up to about 4 days between pours, and anticipating that we could have another thaw and another rain event and that sort of thing, we've agreed that six weeks seems to be a reasonable amount of time to extend the contract, and with the expectation that it can be completed. So I'm asking that you would approve this time extension to the contract.
Any questions? Okay, so I'm going to entertain a motion that is going to need to be contingent.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Okay, I'll go ahead and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing or approving the time extension for the Bainbridge Road culvert project, and the extension will be 48 days to the completion date of March 17th, 2018, and this is to be done under emergency for the purpose of substantially completing the project due to the weather conditions, and this is contingent on the law director's signature.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Anything further? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, that brings us to item number 8, a citywide tree stump removal and pruning contract. Mr. Dursick, how are you this evening?
Fine. How's the committee this evening?
Doing well.
Good.
You had a rough morning.
Yes. But we made it through. We pulled through with flying colors, guys. As managers, you always everybody do. Did a great job.
We appreciate the efforts of everybody.
Thank you. What I'm bringing forward to the committee tonight is a contract for $60,000 for the purpose of removing large hazardous trees, large dead trees, dying disease trees that pose a public health or safety risk. We'd also like to do some trimming with this contract. The contract would be similar to the storm and sanitary, where it's a comparison bid contract, and it would be based on, all the trees would be based on the breast height of diameter of the tree. So if the breast height, which is roughly 5 feet, you would say, Mark?
Yeah.
Say you have a 2.5 foot diameter tree, that would be just a straight price to cut the tree instead of us continually going out to bid or quotes for this. Streamline and make it more efficient down at the service department. We're basically mirroring the city of Cleveland's process, the way they do this contract. And since Van Kuren is usually the cheapest one pretty much every time, this way we'd have a contract in place and we could just utilize a contract instead of having to ask for quotes every time.
Mrs. Meany?
Yeah, well, and I know that, and I believe it was in the fall, and I think I brought this up, where I had some residents who called, you know, and they had ribbons around their trees.
Right.
And so these are the trees you're talking about part of this project, or no?
I believe those trees were taken down already.
Oh, were they already taken down?
I believe so.
You guys are quick.
This would be for anything upcoming.
Oh, okay.
We already have a list that's going to be put into the contract for trimming and removals. And then anything that comes up that's becomes a hazardous tree that we have to remove that our tree guys can't handle in-house.
Right.
This is basically to supplement what we are not able to do in-house.
And these trees are all either on
they're all in the right of way. Nothing is on private property.
Okay, and you just feel this would be easier just to have this go out to bid, and then when you
right, it'd make things more efficient, because right. The way we do this now is every time we have trees, we have to group them together, have to solicit bids from several different contractors, and then we, you know, go through the PO process, and it's just, this would streamline things, especially if we have the need for. That is a hazardous tree that has to be removed immediately.
Right. Okay. That makes sense. Okay.
I would agree. I kind of like the idea of doing this comparative bid project for this. I think it's also proactive in that the emerald ash borer situation isn't going to get any better anytime soon. And we've also had some other issues with fire blight and some of these other things that have been attacking trees, and from a health, safety, welfare perspective, I think it gives us an opportunity, like you had just indicated, to be able to address some of these safety concerns with a dead, dying, diseased tree without having to wait to go through the process of getting, going through the bidding process and everything for each individual tree. So I am definitely supportive of the contract.
I agree.
And I ask that it be passed with emergency clause so I can get this out to bid as soon as possible.
For every other municipality here.
All right, I'll make a motion to the service department to advertise for bids for a citywide tree stump removal and pruning contract to for the 2008 calendar year, not to exceed $60,000, and this legislation passed under an emergency.
Okay, I will second.
We have a motion and a second. Anything further from the committee? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay. That takes us to item number 9, the Four Star Building.
Yes, back in 1997, the city contracted with, it was Minnesota Methane back then, to build this building and use the methane to create electricity to send out into the power grid. This building has not been in use, or the generators have not been in use for at least 12 to 15 years now. As if you look at the aerial photo that I have here, this is Cochran Road, the service department, our compost site, and it's back here by the landfill. This building here is what I'm referring to. Nestle had stopped taking the methane to heat their building back in November also when this 20-year lease was up. Four Star had approached us and asked if we would like to take on the building for whatever municipal use that we see fit. What I'm asking for permission for today is to us to move forward to do some negotiating with the law director and Four Star. And then here's some pictures of the building up close. This is the I believe this is the east side. This is back of the building, the north side, and these are what aluminum cooling towers, basically giant radiators for the generators that were in there. These two items here are a big transformer and a switch gear to change the electricity to get it out into the power grid. All this stuff we would like removed. That's why we want asking for permission from the committee to go negotiate so we can get the building on our terms. If we can't get the building on our terms with what we want, then we would just have Four Star demo the whole building and we'd be able to walk away. But I think we'd be able to utilize this building for cold storage for equipment throughout the winter. That way it's not outside, and then even some of the winter equipment we can put in here so it's not out in the elements throughout the summer. So really I'm asking the committee for permission to move forward and negotiate. Once we negotiate, then we would bring it back to committee to prepare legislation to assume the building.
Mrs. Meany.
Okay, I know I talked to Bill about this earlier. I mean, Bill, do you have any idea, like, cost of what, I know obviously we're going to try to get Four Star to do a lot of this, I would assume. We'll try to get as much as we can.
Yeah,
but I mean, do you have any?
I don't know what their cost would be.
Okay.
The only cost to the city that my goal is to just have the electric bill once a month to give us the 110 and the 240 power into it. There wouldn't be any heat back here. There wouldn't be any water back here.
Okay.
Basically, we're asking them to completely gut the inside of it, take out all of their equipment that they use to generate electricity. There were two generators in there. That's got to come out. There's some penetrations in the roof that would have to be fixed. Obviously, those giant radiators out back would have to be removed. That would all be on them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would, they want to do that because then they would be able to recycle value and the scrap value of all that to offset their costs.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you have enough things that you could use this building. I mean, you have enough.
Okay. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, for example, we have the four V-boxes that go into our salt trucks. Those mm-hmm. can get tucked away in here
right.
in the wintertime. The tractors that we use for roadside mowing, those would be able to fit in here in the wintertime.
Oh, okay.
We do have plenty of equipment that I would like to get out of the weather and get undercover.
What's the square footage?
I honestly don't know off the top of my head. I'm guessing it's, I believe, rough guesstimate, I'm thinking it's, I think it's like maybe 40 by 60, maybe a little bit bigger than that.
Bill, under the terms of the...
I'm sorry?
Under the terms of the lease agreement, does Four Star have an obligation to return the property back to the original condition prior to the building being placed upon it?
Yes.
Okay. So in the event that we're not able to negotiate some sort of agreement to...
Yeah, if we don't have favorable terms to negotiate this, then we would just turn it back to them and say, it's up to you to do the demo work and any remediation that would need to be done, that would all fall on them.
Okay. Bob? Once you do the negotiating, you'll bring that back to us?
Correct. Because we would need legislation
to
assume the building.
So you just need a motion giving permission, basically?
Correct.
Okay, so I'll go ahead. Are you, everybody okay? Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, I'll go ahead then and just make a motion giving permission to the service department and our law department to negotiate with Four Star concerning the building located behind the service department.
6600 Cochran Road.
6600 Cochran Road. Thank you.
Second.
Motion and a second. Anything further? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, we have item number 10, the replacement of a backhoe. We have our fleet manager.
Good evening.
Mike, I think it's the first time you've been back to the committee since you were introduced to us.
Yes,
so
sir. Yes,
welcome
sir.
Back.
Mike Chimsky.
Hello.
Welcome. Yes, the first item on agenda is to replace a 30-year-old Ford backhoe with a new 2018 Caterpillar backhoe. The director, assistant director, and I got the opportunity to view Ohio Cat facility, and we chose this as our choice for it because of their extensive service department that they have, parts department, and also the training facility that they have that our mechanics can go and learn, and also our operators to learn the piece of equipment. And along with that would be a trailer to tow that size backhoe to the different jobs. And the total expenditure for the two items on state contract is $118,829.44. I would like to see if we could pass that legislation under emergency measures to avoid any cost increases for 2018. Right now, we're going to be buying it at 2017 prices.
So there's no bid process for something like this? Mm-hmm.
This is on the Ohio State Procurement Contract,
yeah.
STS contract, and there's evidence of that on the back of the thing showing Ohio Caterpillar as one of their vendors.
Now, Mike, you've been doing this for a while. I know not necessarily in Solon, but you got quite a few years in the league. Is it usually your experience that state bid, that contract is, if we went out to bid just ourselves, that we wouldn't be able to do any better?
Not necessarily, probably with a different type of equipment, but you know, the three of us had got together and had chose this piece of equipment because of the after sale service that they provide, all the training that they provide.
And they'll provide all that in Broadview Heights?
That is correct.
And that the
right.
parts
they,
are located
They just did an
$8
million dollar renovation of their, and they actually bring all their technicians in and train at that facility. Mm-hmm. So it's a perfect fit for us being so close.
I have a quick question.
Mrs. Meany?
What kind of warranty?
The warranty on that is, I believe it's, you know what? Where is it at? I just had it. Give me one second. There's a powertrain warranty, and that is 12 months, unlimited hours, full machine.
Okay. Okay. Do you need separate motions, or can we do them all as one?
For the trailer and the, or for both?
Do we need one separate for the trailer?
I would do them separately.
Separate, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared, approving the agreement for the purchase of a backhoe loader, and this is through the state.
Yes, Ohio State Procurement, STS right. contract. Yes,
STS
ma'am.
Contract. And this will be in the amount of $98,749.24. And this is, like I say, for the backhoe loader. And this is to be done under emergency to avoid any changes or any cost increases.
I'll second.
Motion second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay, then I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared, accepting the purchase of a trailer through the State of Ohio procurement. And this will be in the amount of $20,080.20. And this is also to be done under emergency so that the, just to avoid any possible cost increases.
Second.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay. Item number 11. Replacement of a brush chipper.
Yes, we're going to replace a 1999 Vermeer chipper with a new 2018 Bandit brush chipper. We did our some homework on and see what some of our commercial tree services are using, and Van Curen is one of the ones that we sought out, who does a lot of work for the city. All their chippers are Bandit chippers. I did have a Bandit chipper in my previous employer, and found it to be an excellent piece of equipment. The assistant director and myself and a crew got a chance to demo it, and it has extraordinary safety features on it. The it also has a electric over hydraulic winch that will save some of the backs of our members, and it was amazing on how well it worked for us. And the director was talking about, emergency situations. This will be able to help our emergency people go out and be able to pull large trees off the roadways to get traffic going or so. This is under the National Joint Power Alliance contract, and in the amount of $68,639.04.
Mrs. Meany.
What's the life of one of these, Mike? Like, what? I mean, it's, you know, can do some.
In this application, I would say 10 years.
10 years, okay.
But.
So we won't get the 19 that we got out of the last one.
We're trying not to, sir. Trying to do a better job with that.
I guess I'll make motions. I'll give it a word.
And you don't need this one under emergency?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
All right. I'd like to make a motion to purchase for the service department to replace their current brush chipper with a Bandit brush chipper
through the National Joint Power Alliance contract, number 062117, in the amount of $68,639.04.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmels?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike. Really appreciate that.
Have a good evening.
You too.
That brings us to item number 12, the Water Reclamation Facility Preliminary Treatment Improvements Contract.
Good evening. As promised.
How are you?
Good.
Hello,
how are you doing?
We're doing very well.
As promised, last meeting I said I was going to bring an update virtually for contingency money to refresh everyone's memory for the preliminary treatment improvement project. We have two separate contracts. We have contract A, which is for the general contractor construction with AP Ohoro, and we have contract B, which is with Herbst. That covers the electrical portion of the contract. AP Ohoro, we have a contingency amount of money to cover unknown things that we didn't see in the design, underground piping, things of that nature. That amount was for $250,000. And then contract B, we had $75,000 for electrical work. So as some of these contingency money amounts change, I kind of wanted to keep the committee updated of why and what the amounts were for. So starting with AP Ohoro contract A, I have highlighted in red, this was from the get-go, right when the contract started, AP Ohoro approached us. There was to be a retaining wall that was going to be put on the northeast side of the tank. And they suggested if we, there was a row of trees, virtually probably amounted to about 10 trees. If we would have taken those trees out, it would have saved us about $75,000. So upon review with the engineer, we looked at it and we said, you know what, it's worth doing it. We don't need a retaining wall there. And the trees were more or less scrub trees anyway. So we made a decision to go ahead and remove those trees and save the amount for the retaining wall. So we saved ourselves $75,000. So that increased the contingency money up to $325,000. Then AP Ohoro also approached us later with some changes to various types of fittings that were spec'd. We ran that by the engineer. Actually, the engineer thought they would actually work out better for the situation that they were in. So that saved us another $3,500. So now our contingency amount went up to $328,500. Item number three, DN Tanks construction schedule. We knew it was going to be pushing it to try to get DN Tanks to get the construction of the concrete work done before wintertime. There's a lot of stuff that are preformed walls. And then there's a shotcrete that gets sprayed on the outside of the tank. And the window was very narrow. Once they were awarded the contract to get this done, they virtually had to shut off by about November 15th. So during that time when they got started, it became known to us that we did not do an Indiana BAT survey for clearing the site. So this was basically when AP Ohoro was up clearing the site that this needed to be done. So we worked with the engineer. We had someone come out and review the site. We actually did a study area-wide to see if any of these bats were located anywhere in the area. And the engineer came up with a determination that the study was not needed. We have a recommendation letter. And we were able to move forward with the work. Unfortunately, that amount of time kind of set the time frame for getting that DN tanks to come out and finish that equalization tank. So they had to demobilize. So there was a change order for the amount of $15,000 for them to demobilize and remobilize back in the spring. Item number four, this was just recently We started construction of the grit tanks. We started digging the grit tanks, and we noticed a fiber optic duct bank that was right in the middle where the grit tanks were supposed to be. We didn't have this on any prints anywhere, so obviously it was unknown. We have just negotiated our rectification for this. We got a $15,000 amount from AP Ahorro to dig a new duct bank, kind of demo the old one, and prepare it for the electricians to come in and rework that. What I wanted to mention on this portion of it, if the committee remembers, Councilman Katora and Councilwoman Meany, I approached you for a special PO for Fowler Electric. You know, typically what happens was when you get these change orders, you give the contractor the first shot at his cost to do the change in work. With Herbst Electric, I've seen these amounts come back that are a lot higher than I think they should be. And regarding this fiber optic work, it was around $17,000 is what we were quoted. We were able to get the same work through Fowler for $10,000. And I guess I just wanted to point out that it's, you know, I had to come to the committee for special signatures to do this work, and just to realize that, you know, it's real easy to sit back and just take the change order and just take the contractors. Obviously, the engineer reviews it and he thinks it's within the realm of what the cost of work should be. But, you know, I think we're doing our due diligence to make sure that we're not getting raked over the coals on some of these things that are coming in. So I feel proud that we were able to do that. Give a lot of credit to Clint for coming up with the game plan for how to work this out, because, you know, obviously Arcadis came out. They don't know where all the duct work is. They don't know where all this stuff is. And Clint did his due diligence to do that work to make it work out. So just wanted to point that out. So virtually, with the change order for this fiber optic duct bank for $15,000 for AP Ahorro, we're now down to $298,500, but we're still above what the original contingency money was. So moving to contract B, Herbst Electric. We started out with $75,000. temporary power for a generator. This was necessary because there's in the specs it was called out for the removal of a duct bank. It was unknown that the duct bank was in concrete. So when it was found that it was in concrete, since it wasn't in the design specs, we had to do some changes as far as the demo of the duct bank. Plus, what it also entailed was we had to rent a generator for 2 weeks to power up the building while this work was being done. So that amount came to $21,580.92. Again, to point out, when this amount came in, it was about $39,000. Which I thought, you know, it included man hours for manning the generator, fueling the generator, and for fuel. We were able to save, you know, roughly $10,000 by us doing that work ourselves. The next item was the redo racking, 15,000 kilovolt terminations for transformer A and B. Again, this was something that wasn't in the design specs about the transformers. It was a spec to be an open front transformer, a live front transformer, and what we had there was a dead front transformer. I know this probably doesn't make a lot of sense to you, but just to let you know at least what the difference was. So we looked at that change order to the amount of $8,765.54, bringing our balance down to $44,653.54. The next item was low brake elbows for $21,020.73. When they were doing the transformer changeover and running new wire, had to reuse some of the existing wire. So upon pulling that out, that the wire was damaged and we had to put new low brake elbows on. That amount was $21,020.73. Bringing the total balance to $42,532.81. Any questions regarding that?
I have more of a comment. I mean, I think this is great, Paul. I guess my one question to you, I mean, with these contingencies, you're comfortable that you have enough money here? I mean, this is a huge project. I think, you know, the public needs to know just this is big. This
yeah,
is
it's big. It's so roughly $8.7 million dollar project.
Yeah. That, you know, so far you've just had these, and I mean, you always like to see the red ones, you know, where you're putting money back in. That's a really great thing. But like I say, you're comfortable that...
I'm a little worried about the Herbst Electric one.
Okay,
I was worried about that from the get-go. Usually electric-wise, you run into a lot of things that are unknown. And especially since we have a lot of communications with our SCADA system,
right,
with the new equipment, I have a feeling there's going to be some unknown stuff here that we're going to have to address. So I was hoping that... the possibility was that we could use some of that $250,000, but there are two separate contracts, so I'm not going to be able to do that. So if it does happen, I will have to come back to the committee for something like that. I got my fingers crossed that we can work it out. But
and what kind of contract do you have with this Herbst Electric? I mean, what's is it for the whole
duration? It's for the whole project.
Duration, yeah, so there's no
the
way you
project.
Can...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And I also just want to make a statement. I mean, I really want to commend you, Paul. You know, when you called me about... what had happened and that you found somebody cheaper, but you needed a purchase order. You know, I'm always happy to come and, you know, to save taxpayers money, and that you did beyond, I think, your due diligence to say, wait a minute, this sounds like it's a little over the top, and that you took the initiative to look and see, wait a minute, is there some way or someone that we can get this done cheaper? So I really want to commend you. Like I say, you have so much on your plate with this project, and that you took the time to do that. I just really, really want to commend you, Paul.
Thank you. Thank you. And I like I said, I got to give a lot of credit to Clint for, you know, all the work that he's done. I mean, he's kind of running the project in addition to, you know, his normal duties. So it's a challenge. It's definitely a challenge. And of course, you know, I've had the support of the service department and the engineering department, and I wanted to bring that up too. I don't know if I need to wait till other, but we had the water line break. Do you want me to wait?
No, sure. Okay. We got you.
I think you remember we came to the committee for the water line break that we needed. John had brought the to the committee about that we needed to use our contract for fixing this water line leak, and I can't say enough good about the crew that came out there. For one, Neroni, top notch. I mean, they're very professional, took care of everything, very good guys to work with, very neat. They know I'm real critical on neatness down there, so I mean, they're really, really neat. You know, thanks to the service garage, they came out and helped us try to find it. You know, Mike's crew came out first. We were outside the building initially, trying to locate this water leak, and then we had to actually get some special a special company to come in and try to locate where the leak was at, and luckily he found it was inside the building, so that's why we had to cut the floor out. I brought some pictures if you want to see some of that.
Always like to see visual aids.
But again, you know, I want to thank Mike, the service garage, John, for all their help. I mean, Bill Jakovic was awesome. He came down, He took pictures. He actually has the pictures that we had today, made sure that we had everything taken care of. It was, I just can't say enough how nice it was that someone came to our rescue virtually and helped us, and we didn't have to worry about it. And we knew it was done right, so.
That's great to hear.
So this is inside the building. This is inside our solids building, inside the truck bay. Right behind here is where the water line actually comes into the plant. So this is actually before the meter. We tried to get Cleveland Water to come out and fix it, but they said, "Yeah, it's on private property. We're not going to mess with that." They actually tried to help us locate it, but they couldn't. They couldn't find it either. So this is virtually where the company that we called to locate where the leak was. This is where they said it was. So we started digging in there, and we kind of misled them a little bit because we thought the water line was
along this wall.
Right.
But it turned out to be right in the middle of the bay. Again, this is along the wall we were digging. We ended up digging down about 8 feet, running into a piece of conduit there. This is kind of hard to see, but you start seeing some lines that are more or less the obstacles that the excavator had to try to maneuver. This is a caustic line. This is some of our raw sludge lines that are coming out. Mm-hmm. So we thought that the water line was down here, but it turned out not to be. Like I said, that was a whole first day of digging, and then we ended up moving over to the, we just started cutting across the bay mm-hmm. until we found, Gee. Thought where we found the water line. Here's the actual leak. You can see it spraying up here. And this was really, it was an 8-inch line. We only had it open about halfway. This is with the water off. It had a radial crack all the way around the pipe. The pipe's actually in really good shape. We thought the pipe was going to be rotted out, but it had a radial crack all the way around it. Turns out what made it crack, there was a big rock underneath it. So after all those years, you figure 50-some years sitting on that rock, it finally cracked. Just to let you know that this is what it was repaired with, they put a stainless steel clamp on. I don't know if the committee's ever seen one, but that's what it is. This is the clamp in place on the pipe. They got their safety box here. Bill, you need to help out with this. When they filled the hole in, they put LMS?
LSM, low strength LSM. Mortar.
So because of the old pipes, again, I think Bill and Jakovic, came to the conclusion it'd be better to put this material in instead of gravel because of all the existing pipes that are in there. We didn't want to compress those, you know, when we're trying to for compaction and stuff and worry of damaging the lines. This is, again, putting that LSM in, kind of compacting a little bit. That was the finish of it. Took about 24 hours for that to dry. And then this is the putting the final concrete in. So again, it was a great project, and it was great to have the support from the other departments.
Great. Thank you, Paul.
That will take us to correspondence. We have none. Other, we have none. So that takes us to item number 13 under projects and reports, the engineering department study design report.
The committee has the report from the engineering department in front of them. Just a few things that I want to point out is that we had reviewed 142 permits in the month of January, and we are also working on our annual EPA report with the other public works departments on behalf of the city. That is due April 1st of 2018. Some other items that I want to point out to the committee is the additional survey work that the committee approved for Somme Canyon intersection is completed. Our Somme retaining wall project advertises for bid for the first time starting tomorrow. And we did resubmit our Somme-Aurora intersection improvement plans and just received three comments back from ODOT yesterday. We're trying to get that turned around quickly and get it back for resubmittal, hoping that should end the comments from them. And if there's any other questions from the committee, I can address those now.
Mrs. Meany.
I mean, the big one that I think all the citizens in Solon are wondering about is, of course, the Aurora Somme intersection. Can you give, people keep asking, when's it going to start? Do you have any idea of when?
This little bit of review time's taken up a few weeks we weren't expecting as much time to be used for comments. Once that's approved by the district office, mm-hmm. They have to submit it to the central office at ODOT.
Okay.
That could take 2 weeks.
Okay.
And then I have to advertise it for 1 month.
Right, okay.
And then it'll be back here to the committee for review and approval and council. So I was originally anticipating around April, I was hoping for early April. I may be actually into possibly late April, early May at this point, but I'm hopeful to get it out as soon as we can.
Okay. And then the length of it. I mean, do you think it'll all be done by this year, or do you think it'll go into?
I'm expecting it to still be substantially complete this year.
Okay.
Okay. That's my goal.
Great. Okay, thank you.
So, John, we're not through the District 12 office yet?
No, just down to three comments.
Do you ever feel like they keep moving the finish line?
Every time I resubmit it.
Okay. Okay, as long as I'm not alone. But you're confident, you're feeling pretty good this time that we're going to be able to get this sent down to Columbus.
Yes.
Okay. Any other further questions, Mr. Chairman? Okay, it takes us to item number 14, the 2018 Annual Emergency Road Repair Program Update.
As you can see, we used our new program, which started on January 1st. We used it one time during the month of January on Somm Center Road, northbound at the eastbound entrance ramp to 422. Had to remove and replace a large area of asphalt that was deteriorating, kind of peeling up, and the cost of that was $1,573.
Dan?
Yes.
When we did the resurfacing of Somm,
yes.
Is that part?
It was in that area.
Wasn't that part done there or no?
It was part of the area of the new resurfacing area. And
so
I honestly feel.
Why did it disintegrate?
You know, I saw a lot of water flowing that day in, under, and around the pavement. We didn't replace all the base, so water was coming up under from under the base into the pavement area. Mm-hmm. And the determination, I'm not clear on entirely what caused it to deteriorate, so what we determine is we'll watch it, and if we see any other problems, we'll bring Chagrin Valley out there and tell them that they have a maintenance problem.
Okay. Yeah, I was just going to say, so we can still go after?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
We
okay.
have a bond with them for probably another almost 2 years from this point still.
Okay,
so.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, item number 15, the 2018 Annual Sanitary and Storm System Repair Program Update. Mr. Gilardi.
Yes. Well, the new year, we have a new contractor, Neroni & Son. They've already done one job for us, and it came out pretty good. If you could look at the memo that I sent everybody January 24th, the amount for the culvert ditch removal from Rolling Brook, that's what the contractor from last year. The price did come down from the initial estimate was $68,684, and we are going through the bills right now, and it looks like it's going to come in around $55,654. So it has come down around $13,000. And I know Councilwoman Meany made a comment last meeting about that, and I was hoping that it would come down just for that reason. So. We're still going over the bills, but that's kind of where it looks. But back to Neroni, they're doing a good job. I hear nothing but great things, so I'm very confident about it.
Okay. That was paid on the 2017 contract?
Yes, I did make a typo. That should be on the 2017. Mm-hmm. That's to finish up tracks. And then once that gets all paid, tracks will be done, and then everything is Neroni for this year.
Okay.
I have a quick question. Do we know what did Neroni charge to do the?
You know what? I believe it was approximately around $10,000, but
okay.
It may have gone up a little with the work that was done.
Okay. Yeah, that was the number I had heard, so just, okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Item number 16, Water Reclamation Department report. Paul, do you have anything in particular
anything
you want to point out?
I guess my question, Paul, is, I mean, with the whole water, project, and because when I was on Public Works 3 years ago or whatever, I mean, it started then. I mean, what's your timeline of when, because I know you're doing it in phases. like, when will it be completely done?
This project?
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to be done end of 2018.
18, that's what I thought.
Okay. The electrical contract's going to go a little bit longer because we had to rebid that contract, right. So it's probably going to go into
February.
Okay.
Of 2019 for the electrical portion.
Okay.
So contract B.
Great, thanks.
It takes us to item number 17, the service department report.
Just to remind everyone that, you know, when you do see the snow plows out there, that they are working hard, and please give us plenty of room. Just so the committee's aware, too, I'm sure that especially come next month when you read the financials, the overtime numbers will probably be skewed a little bit due to the fact of the time, unfortunate timing of the snow and when it's coming. So you probably will notice they're skewed a little bit, but then they'll be back under control, you know, once the year moves on.
It does seem like the snow has not been falling during what would be the most optimal times for us, schedule-wise, that's for sure. So it seems like we get it on the weekends, on Sundays. And this was a very strange sort of snow event that we kind of had. It seemed like Solon was getting hit when not a lot of other people were, and it seemed like it was pretty heavy. But I really appreciate the efforts of everybody now at the service department.
You know, I can't thank my managers and the guys. They do a great job. It wasn't for them. You know, they put 110% in, so, you know, all the kudos goes to them.
Tell them we appreciate it.
Absolutely. I would like everyone to take a look at their calendar to see if we may have the ability to potentially move the Public Works meetings for the next 2 months. And one of the things that I was thinking about doing was the next scheduled Public Works meeting would be scheduled for March 7th. And so I was thinking perhaps we could do it prior to the council meeting on the 5th, if how that would work for everybody, probably, 5 o'clock.
That.
I didn't think we could get a lot of
resistance.
I was
going to say, you're probably like, yay, no.
And,
I don't think you'll get any resistance from the administration.
Okay, so the March meeting, Patty, we'd like to move to 5 p.m. on Monday, March 5th, and the April meeting is scheduled now for April 4th, Wednesday, April 4th. We have a council meeting on Monday, April 2nd, and I would like to do the same thing, move that to 5 p.m. on the 2nd. John, are we okay with that? I think this gives an opportunity to get the final passage.
I think it's a great recommendation.
I think this gives an opportunity to not have to wait 2 weeks from the time of our Public Works meeting to the time when council as a whole will be able to pass the legislation. So, okay, Patty.
Okay.
We're good with that.
Okay.
Mr. Solonix.
Before you end, I forgot I got one other thing.
Sure.
Patty, I think she had called me that we, Peggy Weil was supposed to come and talk about the tap-in fees.
Correct.
The more or less what her view was, or if she's gotten any comments from anyone that's come into the city or done any changes. So she said there wasn't a whole lot. She gave me a couple things that I'm just gonna mention here. Number one, Mitchell's Ice Cream. They saved about $850 for the new rates, and I think that was basically revolved around the patio charges that we did. You know, we reduced that by 25%. Two others were not affected, so two other businesses that came into town, both moved into an existing building. There was fees involved, but they were not affected by the new rates. She did mention that the property owner at Mitchell's said that there should not be tap-in fees only for new fixtures. And he said Medina doesn't charge anything for tap-in fees. So just to kind of let the committee know, when I started investigating this, you could go for so many cities and there were so many different scenarios that I couldn't make any rhyme or reason to why certain cities did things a certain way. So again, basically the purpose of the tap-in fees is to pay for new connections, and they were established when the treatment plant was upgraded from 3.1 to 5.8 million gallons, and it was more or less to recover the cost of that construction per gallon virtually, and that's how those rates were calculated. So change in use, the way we're looking at change in use is, you know, if they're adding more people there, so more water usage, things like that, that's what we calculated in when we figured out those tap-in rates. Mm-hmm. And we calculated that in when we're looking at that for the new rates. Mm-hmm. And the difference was is that, you know, some of those charges were not really reflective of what real water usage was. So when we reviewed that, we looked at the actual application, compared it to what we thought typical water rates were, and actually even compared them to water readings that we had. So, you know, I feel very confident in the numbers that we have and we came up with. So that's it.
Thank you.
Are you aware, does Medina charge a tap-in fee?
I'm not sure. No, I mean, he said that they don't. I didn't investigate that to see whether they did or not.
Okay, I will entertain a motion to adjourn, and I will make a motion to adjourn.
I guess I'll second it.
All right, we have a motion and a second.
Sorry,
anything further? I'm cool with it. Anything further, then we'll proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.